Spiritual family, welcome to another installment of our 21-day lockdown devotions. We are your interns. I am Wiseman Kamanga.
And I am Carsten Rembold. As you know, we have been traveling through 1 Peter, and we currently find ourselves in 1 Peter chapter 3, from verse 8 to verse 12. Wise, if you could please read that passage for us.
All right, please follow with me in your Bibles. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you are called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it, for the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Carsten, why don't you kick us off here by helping us with verse 8?
Sure. And so I think the important thing first is we see the word finally. That tells me Peter is really about to say something important. He's setting it up for something important. And we can see by looking at the passage that he really is giving us a summary of from chapter 2 verse 12 till up to chapter 3 verse 7. And we can see even going through, he speaks about subjecting yourselves to authority, subjecting husbands to wives, wives to husbands. We can see from that he's really summarizing these into these core qualities that he gives us, which are unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. But Wise, maybe you can help me sort of better understand, why are these qualities so important?
Well, these qualities that Peter has been just drawing out in his letter to these Christians are qualities that have an eternal value. You know, I think Peter in this section, he's trying to encourage his believers who are in a very difficult context. And I think we'll get into the context a bit later, but the heart of what this part is saying here is that he's really trying to encourage these believers, trying to encourage them to live out these qualities that have an eternal significance. And I think you can see that in his example of that, an example that he gives to the wives, that they should not look for the adorning that is external, but look for the adorning that is internal, that actually is precious in God's eyes. And so the essence of these qualities is that they are eternal, they are of eternal value. So Carsten, maybe you can help us out with verse 9. Verse 9 seems very familiar.
Yeah, verse 9 we've seen before in chapter 2 verse 23. When he was reviled, he did not revile. In turn, when he suffered, he did not threaten. And we can see the he they're speaking about there is Jesus. And so we see that there is not a disconnected reality of Peter saying, do this and go. He's saying, Jesus has done, therefore follow. Right? We can see that in chapter 3, verse 21, where we're called to follow his example that he set before us. Right? We really are called to follow as Jesus did, live the life that he lived. Bring that out together, that even in the qualities he showed, we ought to live in the qualities Jesus has given us. We see this completely through even the building up into the temple, through the fact that we are given as a holy nation, a royal priesthood. We are bound together with Jesus in the way that we should live and what we ought to do. And so that really is just a comfort, I think, to me. We've not been left alone, but we're left to follow what Jesus has done before us. We're not called to do something that is separate from God and what he's doing and providing and lived out before us. But I can see here that it's interesting that he follows almost like a Matthew 5 mentality, where he says, don't just not revile, but bless. And that to me is interesting, because once again, it's almost a complete contrast to the world we live in. But it's interesting to me that he says, do this that you may obtain a blessing. Maybe, Wise, you can help me better understand, what is this blessing that Peter's speaking about when he speaks here?
Well, the blessing that he's speaking about is a blessing that he's mentioned right through the previous passages. And this is the blessing of an eternal hope. This is an eternal hope. I mean, I think when you read verse 4 in chapter 1, it says they have been blessed with an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for them by God. This is the blessing that he's talking about. He's talking about in verse 9, chapter 1, verse 9, it says, they are going to be obtaining the outcome of their faith, which is this blessing, the salvation of their souls. We see it in verse 23 of chapter 1. It says, since you have been born not to perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and abiding word of God. So this is essentially the blessing that these people have. And I think we ought to remember, Carsten, that Peter is writing this to a context where these people, these Christians, are being persecuted. They're experiencing a lot of difficulty. They're dispersed, they're exiled, they are being persecuted where they are, and he's writing these things, working hard to remind them, to look up in the midst of what is happening here, in the midst of where they're at. He's reminding them, saying, we have to look up. We have an eternal hope that is secured for us in heaven. And so this is the blessing that Peter is trying to encourage these believers who are going through a very difficult time, who are going through hardships in this season, and he's just saying to them, guys, in the midst of what is happening here, we're not dismissing this, but deal with this, handle this, engage with these circumstances with knowing the fact that you have an imperishable, undefiled, and unfading blessing that is kept for them in heaven. And so this is such this is such great news, don't you think, Austin?
Yes, it definitely is. And I think for me, when I look at just the way we approach this, even in the midst of COVID-19, everything we're going through, life's difficult, life's tough. I think there's a lot of realities that people are facing now, which is difficult. We're looking at most probably people losing jobs and things like that as a result of this. And I think this is quite a comfort to me, even just the fact that we can think of the eternal. I'm so prone to think of the temporary and what's happening to me now, my situation now. But Peter calls us here, if we look in from verse 10, we see this psalm, which is Psalm 34. He calls us towards action, which is saying, keep your tongue from evil, keep your lips from speaking deceit, turn away from evil, do good, seek peace and pursue it. Really just saying, we ought to live now in our temporary attitude with those qualities, looking at the way we live life with a focus on the eternal. I think to me that's a bit of a contrast to saying, don't look at your situation now. Look where you can see others who are less off than you in light of what you're living for, which is an eternal hope. But maybe wise, you can help me just better understand what is your sort of takeaway from this passage.
No, I think I agree with what you're saying. I think Peter is definitely calling us not to dismiss our circumstances and not to also be bogged down with what's happening right now. I think he's calling us to conduct ourselves in a specific manner. And I think what comes to mind is what he says in chapter 2, verse 12. He says, keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. And that's essentially what he's saying in verse 12 here of this chapter. He says, for the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. And so we need to remember God's eyes are on us, you know. And so as we apply this to us in our day, God is watching us, you know. The Lord has his eye on us. Psalm 139, such an encouraging psalm. It reminds us that God, the creator of heaven and earth, I think we need to pause and think, who is this God? This God searches us and he knows us. And so in our conduct, we ought to conduct ourselves in a manner that is honorable and glorifying to him.